Okay, but get ready, y'all. I'm about to drop me a lid. Crap. Greetings, one and all, and welcome once again to Tom's Hit Parade, continuing my end-of-the-decade spectacular-ish, my week-long celebration of my favorite music of the 2010s. I hope you guys have had a whole lot of fun watching it. I've had a whole lot of fun bringing it to you, and there's more to come. Yes, today's video is basically the metaphorical wind-up to the proverbial pitch that will be the grand finale, which in this case will be my ranked list of my 100 favorite albums of the 2010s. Yes, you will not want to miss this. That'll be coming to you tomorrow and the next day. But what is in today's video, you ask? Just a couple of quick little lists. I thought it would be fun to talk about my favorite artists of the 2010s. Just a quick list of, a list of 15 with a handful of honorable mentions. And speaking of honorable mentions, the second part of my video will be kind of a warm-up to the big list where I will give you my 25 honorable mentions for albums of the decade. Yes, think of that as just whetting your appetite for the big list coming up. But for now, first things first, my favorite artists of the 2010s. Now, this list is mainly determined by what you would assume it is determined by, how many albums these artists put out during the decade, and how many of them I've bought and enjoyed, and how much I enjoyed them. But there are also a couple of artists you'll see on this list, and this is more on the honorable mentions, not on the list itself, who may not have put out anything, or at least very little, during the decade of the 2010s, but still occupied my listening hours to a substantial degree. So let's just get on with actually those three honorable mentions are pretty much the only artists on the list that applies to. So let's get those three out of the way first. Not that I'm trying to shoo them along or that they're insignificant or anything. Don't let it sound like that. My first three honorable mentions, the first two are both thanks to my sister, Steely Dan and the Eagles. And yes, they haven't put out anything in many, many years, but they were two of the artists whose CDs were most plentiful in my sister's CD collection, which I inherited in 2015. And so I came to like their music a lot. I like the Eagles singles for as long as I can remember, but this gave me the chance to explore some of their studio albums. And she only had a couple of their studio albums in her collection, but that prompted me to pick up the Eagles Legacy box set, which was in 2018, I think it was. And I got that for my birthday one year, and I was just really, really appreciated it. I liked what I heard in my sister's collection so much that it prompted me to get their studio albums. And as far as Steely Dan, my sister actually had six of their studio albums in her collection, and they only made nine studio albums, so having a little bit of OCD-ish completist tendencies in me, I of course had to go out and pick up the remaining three studio albums that she didn't have. So, and of course I grew to enjoy their music more and more over the decade. So thank you, Kimmy, for those two. So yeah, Steely Dan and the Eagles. And the third honorable mention on that part of the honorable mentions list, yes, there are more, is Billy Joel. And I think we all know who to thank for that. Yes, one of my closest friends, it's almost as near and dear to my heart as my sister is, Noah Estes. Billy Joel is one of Noah's all-time favorite artists. And I, of course, was familiar, being an 80s kid myself, was familiar with all of his singles. I had his four-disc Greatest Hits collection in my set in my collection for a long, long, long time. But he convinced me to pick up their 11 of Billy Joel's studio albums, which I actually mostly found pretty inexpensively, so it was not a huge investment in money, but it ended up being a huge investment in time, because he and I did a collaborative video on, I believe it was on his channel, ranking our favorite Billy Joel albums. And of course, in order to do that, I had to put in a lot of listening hours on Billy Joel, and really, really came to like a lot of his deep album cuts and his studio albums as full separate works of art. So thank you so much, Noah, for turning me on to much more of Billy Joel than I ever had been familiar with before. So there's that list of honorable mentions. And as for the other tier of honorable mentions, if you will, these are actually artists that were productive during the decade of the 2010s, most of whom I discovered or rediscovered over the course of this decade and have come to grow quite fond of. Jamie Cullum is actually the one holdover, if you will, or legacy artist that I have enjoyed throughout the previous decade of the 2000s. So he's kind of a stalwart in my list, if you will. The other four are Sondra Lerche, Madeleine Peru, The Stripes, and Neon Trees. So those are my lists of honorable mentions, and now let's get on to the list itself of my favorite artists of the 2010s. Now, kicking off the list at number 15 is Duran Duran. And yes, that is surprisingly low for them, considering that they're one of my favorite artists of all time. It's just there are a couple different reasons for this. First of all, their output during the 2010s was rather sparse. They only put out two studio albums during the decade. And in my opinion, over the grand scheme of Duran Duran's decade, their more recent albums have not been amongst my favorites. So yeah, that is why they are ranked low enough. But still, I had to have them on the list, honestly. Coming in at number 14 on my list is Kacey Musgraves. Yes, a country artist and a female artist. Two categories of artists that I couldn't have imagined ending up on my favorite artists of the decade list a decade ago, back in the 2000s. But yeah, she's just, for one thing, she goes against the grain of your typical country music. She puts messages in her music that you really just don't find in your run-of-the-mill country artists. I mean, that's one thing. And she's just got this attitude, this spunky attitude that just... I don't know, it just endeared me to her right away. I've picked up each of her three albums as they came out, and her most recent album, Golden Hour, of course, was absolutely fantastic. Ever since I ranked it at number three during its year, 2018, I think it was, I've had second thoughts about putting it higher on my list. So, yeah, those are just a couple of the reasons why Kacey Musgraves is on my list of favorite artists of the 2010s. Now, number 13 on my list is jazz artist Diana Krall. Now, as with Steely Dan and the Eagles, she is an artist that I can thank my sister Kimmy for turning me on to. Kimmy must have had half a dozen of her albums in her CD collection that she left me, and I just became so enamored of her music that I had to go out and buy the rest of her albums. But unlike Steely Dan and the Eagles, she was very productive in the 2010s. She's put out four albums over the course of the past decade, each of which I've absolutely adored and enjoyed. Just a fantastic voice, fantastic arrangements, just an all-around great artist, so one that I am very proud to have on my list. Number 12 on my list is Weird Al Yankovic. Come on, that's me you're talking to. I mean, how could I not have Weird Al on my list of favorite artists of the decade? Come on. Now, I may not have spent quite as much time listening to him or picking up his new albums as some of the other artists on this list. He only put out two albums over the course of the 2010s. But in terms of how much money I spent on a particular artist, Weird Al probably would rank at number one because I bought his huge Complete Works box set in the accordion packaging, and of course I went to his ridiculously self-indulgent, ill-advised vanity tour front row seat back in 2018, so yeah. I'm a Weird Al fan who will never die. Well, my fandom will never die, let's put it that way. So yes, I couldn't rank him any lower on the list. I really wanted to rank him higher, but well, there you go. Weird Al has got a space on my list, definitely. My number 11 pick is Keb Mo. And yes, if you've been paying attention enough to my channel, you kind of knew that name was coming, didn't you? Yes, the 2010s was the decade in which I discovered Keb Mo, an excellent contemporary blues artist. I only have three out of the four albums that he put out this decade, studio albums, that is, and one of them was actually a collaboration with Taj Mahal. But yeah, the reason he's number 11 on my list is because I just spent so much time listening to him. I bought nearly all of his studio albums over the last 3 or 4 years. Just fantastic artist, and he took up a lot of my listening hours over the decade. So yeah, that's why he is number 11 on my list. Number 10, Weezer. Yeah, they were pretty much bound to be on this list too, weren't they? Yes, even if the 2010s hadn't been the decade in which I discovered, or rediscovered, I guess, Weezer, they still would have racked up the listening hours, I would have imagined, because they put out a whopping 6 albums over the course of the past decade. And I bought every one of them, and also, as if that weren't enough, all of their past discography as well. All 13, I think, of their albums. 13, 14, something like that. This has been, over the course of the past 2 years, 3 years. So yeah, a relatively short time span, and yes, I crammed a lot of listening, probably more than I should have, into a short time span like that. So I honestly don't remember a lot of what a lot of their albums sounded like, but... So I'm going to have to, listen to them over the course of a more spread out amount of time to really absorb their material. But yeah, I mean, as much listening time, as I said, that they took up in my decade of the 2010s, they couldn't not be on this list. Coming in the number 9 spot is Mika. Yes, another artist that ranked lower than I kind of was expecting them to rank. And I tried to balance this list with all the criteria, the number of albums they put out in the decade, how much I listened to them, and how highly they ranked on my individual year-end lists. And despite the fact that Mika ranked consistently in my top 10 in various spots, he did only put out 3 studio albums over the decade, And, you know, there were just artists who either put out more albums or put out albums I enjoyed more and were in heavier rotation for me. So despite that, Mika is a perennial favorite of mine. He is just a fantastic artist. I love him to death. And yeah, I couldn't not have him in my top 10. Number 8 on my list of favorite artists of the 2010s is Troye Sivan. Now, actually, Troye didn't put out as many studio albums as Mika did during the 2010s. Mika put out 3 and Troye only put out 2, but I do have one of Troye's EPs on CD, which he also put out in the 2010s. But what edges Mika out in terms of Troye is his voice. There's just something about his voice, that's like an ethereal, fragile beauty in his voice that just grabbed my ear instantly and just locked onto me and made a profound impact on me. And I might like more of Mika's songs, individual songs, and his albums might rank higher, in some instances anyway, than Troye's do. But just as far as just the impact that an artist has had on me and, you know, just my ability to more profoundly feel his music, Troye edges him out in that respect, and he's just his music just kind of draws me in, as I said, and I basically haven't been able to stop listening to him since. My 7th favorite artist of the 2010s is Seth MacFarlane. Yes, a bit of an odd choice, but I've got a few reasons for that. For one thing, he was one of the more productive artists during the decade. He put out actually 4 albums over the course of the 2010s, every one of which I had to buy as soon as I possibly could. He's had me from the get-go because I realized early on what a fantastic, magnificent voice he had. That's another reason why he's so high on my list. His voice is just absolutely flawless, especially when it comes to singing those old-time standard songs of the 30s and 40s and 50s. He's just got the perfect voice for that. He ranks right up there with Michael Bublé and Frank Sinatra in terms of just the vocal prowess and the phrasing and just a perfect vibrato, and everything about his voice is just fantastic. And the other reason he's so high on my list is he makes his albums interesting by putting on the more obscure songs from that era. You know, he doesn't put on the songs that, you know, you can find on any easy listening album from that era. It's just some of the much more obscure and off the beaten path songs. So it makes his albums much more interesting to listen to. So, I absolutely had to have Seth MacFarlane on my list, and he's at number 7. Number 6 is Sara Bareilles. Now, not only is Sara one of the artists, amongst several on this list, that I've been a fan of since day one, since her first major label studio album came out, but also she's one of the artists whose output has been most consistent, not just through this past decade, but throughout her career that I've followed. Now, I do only have 3 out of the 4 studio albums she put out during the decade. I'm missing one, so that's one reason why she's ranked a little bit lower. But the albums that I do have always ranked consistently in usually my top 10. I think one of them was just slightly out of my top 10 that during its year. So she's just a fantastic artist. And not only that, but sprinkled in amongst her hit singles over the years have been a bunch of very inspirational and uplifting self-empowerment anthems that are just irresistible. And I just put a smile on my face and a good feeling in my heart every time I hear him. So yeah, those are just a few of the reasons why Sara Bareilles is ranked at number 6 in my countdown. Okay, now here we have arrived in the top 5 of my list of my favorite artists of the 2010s. My number 5 is Charlie Puth. Okay, when you're talking consistency, yes, Sara Bareilles is going to outrank Charlie Puth in that respect. A lot of people a lot of people hated his debut album 9-Track Mind. I have said before, and I'll say it again, I've got a soft spot for it. I don't necessarily love that album, but I like it. You know, I'll defend its merits, you know, to my dying breath, practically. I've listened to it several times since it's come out, and I have not grown tired of it, or it doesn't grate on my nerves at all, really. But of course, when you're talking his sophomore album, Voice Notes, that was a vast, huge improvement. That was my number 2 album for its year. So, in my opinion, the quality of Voice Notes offsets the quality of 9-Track Mind in terms of his deservedness for ranking at number 5 on my list. Another thing about him is, kind of like Troye Sivan, his voice is just absolutely unmistakable. That little bit of a huskiness is just totally endearing. And, you know, he's even got it when he hits those falsettos. And it just draws me in. It glues my ear to the music whenever I hear it. I'll give you an example. When I was having lunch at a sub shop during work one week, and you know, over the hustle and bustle of the noise in the restaurant, I heard Attention when it came on the radio, and I instantly could tell that was Charlie's voice. That is how unmistakable Charlie's voice is, and how appealing it is to me, at least. So that alone, just and you know, the fact that I cannot wait to see what he comes up with next for his next album. You know, hey, Charlie Puth ranks at number 5 very easily, in my opinion. Number 4 on my list is Jake Bugg. Now, for one thing, I bought all 4 of this guy's albums that he put out during the 2010s, and I love them all. And secondly, much like Mika and, to a bit of a lesser degree, Sarah Bareilles, Jake Bugg's albums have almost always consistently ranked in my top 10 for their respective years. So that's just, you know, those are just 2 of the reasons. And another reason is, with Jake Bugg, almost every one of his albums, he brings a little something different to the table. The most notable difference is his 3rd album, On My One, which was he was a little experimental in that. He put in some hip hop, a little bit of electro in another song, kind of, and some country in another song. He was kind of all over the map, but still, to me, that was a really, really good album, and I really enjoyed it. So even his least favorite albums of mine are still favorites, and I can't wait to see what that guy does next. He hasn't put out an album in a couple of years, but I'm really hoping, really eager to see what he brings us in the 2020s. So yeah, he is my number 4 favorite artist of the 2010s for a really good reason. Coming in at number 3 is Bleachers. I knew they were going to be on the list somewhere, but color me surprised. When all was said and done and I'd gone over each artist's discographies in detail, you know, with all the songs that I really enjoyed, how much I enjoyed each individual song, as well as each album as a unit, it just, you know, they just kept crawling up and up the list, and they won me over like I didn't really expect them to. I did not expect Bleachers to be nearly this high on the list. But yeah, and we pretty much know who to thank for this. Well, mostly we have Noah to thank for this, for introducing me to Bleachers, but it was also the movie, one of my favorite movies of the 2010s, Love, Simon. Jack Antonoff was the music supervisor on the soundtrack. Not only that, but a few of Bleachers' songs appeared in the soundtrack. So, you know, I couldn't not love the music, especially when it was included in that movie. And just, you know, when I looked at their albums, Noah persuaded me to look at their albums, and I just saw how much more they had to offer. And not only do I have both of their studio albums, but I also have their Bleachers Unplugged vinyl album, which is just as fantastic as their other albums. It just gives a new spin on a lot of the songs, and it's just very, very enjoyable. So I cannot wait to see what Bleachers has in store for us during the 2020s. And just, yeah, they're number 3. Who to thunk it? Okay, my runner-up for favorite artist of the 2010s is Tom Odell. And yes, very much like Bleachers, Tom was unexpectedly high on this list. He just kept creeping up and up the list as I was refining it. And one of the things is his voice. Kind of like Troy Sivan and Charlie Puth, he's just got an unmistakable voice. It's got a little bit of an idiosyncrasy to it. And one of the things I've mentioned before is I love voices that have little quirks to them, little imperfections that make them endearing to me. And that is Troy's voice. And another thing is he makes consistently great albums. One big reason why he's so high on my list is his most recent album, Jubilee Road, was fantastic. If I were redoing my 2018 list now, I would probably rank it a lot higher than I did. I think I ranked it at number 8 or number 7 that year. But with every listen I give it and his previous albums, they just keep growing on me more and more. He also did a track, sang on a track for Kygo, an EDM artist, and I really, really loved that song too. And one of my favorite songs of the 2010s was a single from Jubilee Road, If You Want to Love Somebody. Fantastic song. I just absolutely loved it. I'm not doing a favorite songs of the 2010s list, but that would be in the top 10 definitely. So, but yeah, for all those reasons and more, Tom Odell is runner-up for my favorite artist of the 2010s. Okay, here it is, the moment you've been waiting for, my number 1 favorite artist of the 2010s, and those of you who have been paying close enough attention not only to this video in particular, but to my channel in general, will probably recognize a name that has been missing thus far from this list, and let me keep you in suspense no longer. My favorite artist of the 2010s is Wouter Hamel. Yes, he was pretty much, you know, after all was said and done, you know, I'd gone over all the artists that I really listened to a lot this decade, it was pretty much a no-brainer, you know, no argument there, that Wouter Hamel is the artist that pretty much defined my listening over the decade, not just in terms of hours spent listening to his music. He's put out, actually, by the way, 4 albums during the past decade, and I bought not only those albums, but every album previous, which I think was only 1 or 2 additional ones. But also, he has a very special connection for me to my sister, because he was the first artist that I really, really got into and really, truly loved listening to after the death of my sister. when my sister passed away in 2012. It was about, you know, when she passed away, I was kind of, you know, I couldn't listen to music for a while, which was kind of understandable because I had really bonded with my sister over music. And so it was a bit of a place of pain for a little while, for, you know, 6, 7 months, 8 months, better part of a year. And then one day in the spring of 2013, I think, I was on eBay looking for an album to put into my shopping cart to take advantage of a shipping discount, of all things. And I happened upon this guy, Wouter Hamel. I'd never heard of him before. Went over to YouTube and started listening to his songs, and every song I listened to, I liked more than the previous one. And that, you know, after like the fifth or sixth song, I took that as a message from my sister. It felt like it was from my sister anyway, saying, "Hey, here's your chance to love music again," was basically what it felt like my sister was telling me. And so, I had to buy not only the one album that I saw on eBay, but I went and bought every album I could find of his on eBay, which was, I think, 3 at the time. And so, you know, and I don't even remember what the original album was that I was looking for, but I think I dropped that one and just picked up Wouter Hamel's albums. Bought them all and have bought every album since then, and almost every single album he's put out I've enjoyed more than the previous one. There's an exception to that, which you'll see in my Albums of the Year list coming up here very quickly. But as I said, the one artist that basically defined my listening over the decade without question is Wouter Hamel. I absolutely love the guy's music. He is a jazz pop artist. He kind of followed the same sonic trajectory, I guess you'd say, that Jamie Cullum has. Jamie Cullum started out with jazz standards, and you know, his music was very much in a jazz frame of mind, but he's since evolved into more of a pop sensibility, kind of like Jamie Cullum did. So, but yeah, check out Wouter Hamel if you haven't yet. I've sung his praises, pun intended, repeatedly on this channel, I'm sure. And I'll keep singing his praises till my dying breath. He's just fantastic. I cannot wait to see what he comes out with for the 2020s. So, Wouter, if you're watching, love you, man. Keep making music, and I'm going to keep listening to it. So, there you have it. That is my list of my favorite artists of the 2010s. I hope you enjoyed it. But don't go anywhere yet. I still got one little part to this video. As I mentioned at the beginning, I wanted to give you a little bit of a preview, a little warm-up to my list of 100 favorite albums of the 2010s by giving you my 25 honorable mentions. And these are not ranked. These are just in alphabetical order. So let's just get to it right quick here. American Authors, Oh What a Life. Coldplay, A Head Full of Dreams. Jamie Cullum, The Pursuit. Brett Denon, Smoke and Mirrors. Nick Jonas' self-titled album. Sondra Lerche's self-titled album. Melodrama by Lord. Molly Music's album Molly Is. Declan McKenna, What Do You Think About the Car? Giorgio Moroder, Deja Vu. Hero by Maren Morris. Before the Sun Goes Down by The New Respects. The 1975's I Like It When You Sleep. Midnight Memories by One Direction. Wheelhouse by Brad Paisley. Gossamer by Passion Pit. Pentatonix self-titled album. Lickety Split by Robert Randolph and the Family Band. Pony by Rex Orange County. Nightwork by the Scissor Sisters. Science and Faith by The Script. Return to Paradise by Sam Sparrow. Racine Carrée by Stromae. Harry Styles' self-titled album. And the self-titled album by Super Heavy. Well, there you go. I hope you enjoyed that quick little rundown of the titles that almost made my list of my 100 favorite albums of the 2010s. And that list is coming up starting with the next video. You're not going to want to miss this. It's going to be a lot of fun. Hopefully not too much fun. But anyway, yes, that is it for this video. I hope you enjoyed it. Suggestions, questions, constructive criticisms, lay them on me in the comments section below. Also, scroll down to the description for the link to my Twitter feed and links to my favorite fellow YouTubers who are all worth checking out. And don't forget to subscribe to my channel and browse my past videos, and be sure to ring that notifications bell so you'll be the first to know each time I drop a new video. Otherwise, thank you so much for watching. I'll see you next time, and remember, life's too short to be a music snob.